Please rise. Grace, mercy, and peace be to you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. The text for this morning's sermon is the Holy Gospel, as you have heard read, and our theme this morning, the Annunciation of our Lord Jesus the Christ. Please be seated. My dearest brother and sister in Christ Jesus, human life begins with a miracle. In conception, cells merge to create a zygote, and that grows into a blastocyst. Within just a few weeks, it becomes an embryo. Human life is amazing. It's a miracle of God. Every human birth points to a loving, merciful God who transcends all our understanding. To this, the psalmist writes and attests that he praises God for his own birth, as you should praise God for your own birth, confessing, "Thou didst form my inward parts, thou didst weave me in my mother's womb." So it is the greatest of miracles that by the power of the Holy Spirit, God was conceived in the womb of a virgin and was made man. In this, we must be very clear. All men, all women without exception, born of a human father, are born in sin. And that sin comes with our fallen flesh. We know it is original sin, sin that we have inherited from our father Adam. Dear one, we are not sinners because we sin, as if sinning would exempt us from the curse. Rather, we sin because we are sinners, because we do not have a choice. Try to be sinless for just one day. Go ahead, try it. Attempting to be perfect for just one day by your will or your work will result in utter failure. So we hear the prophecy, the virgin will conceive. The virgin will conceive. If there's ever an oxymoron, here it is, a virgin conceiving. A woman cannot conceive unless she ceases to be a virgin, except this miraculous work of God. A virgin did conceive, and not just conceive another human being, but a human being in whom God dwells fully. Fully God and fully man. He is the God-man. And this is our confession. And in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost and born of the Virgin Mary. That is the faith, that is the confession that you and I believe in. That's the faith that you and I were taught by faithful parents and grandparents, by faithful Sunday school teachers and faithful pastors for your whole life. And that's the faith that we confess to the very world. This faith is the hope and the salvation offered to you and offered to the entire world. Yet it is a mystery indeed, as you heard in our epistle lesson. It truly is a mystery, because it is beyond human intellect and beyond human reason. We like to think that we know more than God. Let me tell you a little secret. You don't. The truth can only be understood by faith. By faith. That God alone speaks into being. Just as your faith was spoken into being right here when you were brought to this font as a child and God spoke your faith into being. I baptize thee in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost. Not your work, his work. So in Mary's womb was Jesus Christ spoken, incarnate by the power of the Holy Spirit, by the power of God's word, proclaimed by the angel Gabriel, who was sent by God to announce that the King is about to be born, that he's about to come into the world. And so he did, born of a virgin. The temptation of this text is to talk too much about the virgin. Even in Lutheran circles, there are too many pages written about Mary, about her virginity, about her words, about her submission to the Lord. All of this is true. She did all of this, and she was a virgin. Yet we should read the text, dear one. Read the text. If you read the text and think about it, very little is actually said about Mary. Remember, you've heard this before. It's about Jesus. Therefore, our focus, our attention is placed squarely on God's announcement of the incarnation of his Son. God uses this text to teach us about the virgin birth, that Jesus is the Son of God and the work of the Holy Spirit in our Lord's conception in the womb of a virgin. And this is also our confession in the Nicene Creed. Concerning Jesus, we confess, was incarnate by the Holy Ghost of the Virgin Mary and was made man. Jesus is the Son of God, the Holy One of God. Jesus is set apart by our Father in heaven to do a specific task, to fulfill the plan of salvation, to cleanse Israel, to cleanse all humanity, to cleanse you and me from all sin, so that you and I and all men may inherit the promised kingdom. Gabriel, the angel Gabriel, uttered God's message to Mary over 2,000 years ago. The promise in these words has come to pass. The baby was born, and he was named Jesus, God saves, as Gabriel said. Jesus kept all the promises given by his Father and by himself. His life is perfect in every way. And like our lives, never perfect in any way. Nevertheless, through his perfect life, he suffered the cruelty of death upon a cross. Because of his death, he conquered death for you. Death could not hold him, and he rose from the dead. And on the third day, he guaranteed to us that death has no hold on us. Yesterday, this was proclaimed right here. Death has no hold on our dear sister who's now at rest, and death has no hold on you, just as he promised. Before Jesus ascended into heaven, he made a promise. Sometimes we forget. You know, people make promises to us all the time. I've even been guilty of this because I'm a sinner. I've made promises to some of you, and I didn't fulfill my promise. Please forgive me. I'm a sinner, just like you. But when God makes a promise, he fulfills that promise 100% of the time. Never does he break a promise. And here's this promise that he made just before he ascended into heaven. Behold, I am with you always, to the very end of the age. How does Jesus keep this promise? Well, we hear in our text that Gabriel said that the Holy Spirit will come and that he would come over Mary, that he would overshadow her. God comes to you the very same way. God comes and overshadows you here, again, at the font. This is what he does. He comes and overshadows you. And then he promises to continually come to you. And he continues to come to you as you come to the altar and he serves you his body and blood. As you take his body and blood into your body, he is filling you. He is filling you fully, just as Mary was fully filled, by the power of the Holy Spirit. We are also filled the very same way. This is the importance of the sacraments. We should never dispel the sacraments and throw them out. The sacraments are God's promise to us of his grace. He's always coming to us, always reminding what he is doing for us, just as you heard with your children. He is constantly giving us a gift, the gift of his kingdom. And he promises this to us in body and in blood and in word. So Gabriel greets Mary and says, "Greetings, O favored one. The Lord is with you." He says the same words to you, maybe a little bit differently. "Greetings, O favored ones," or people of God. "The Lord is with you." His greeting is not only very polite. His greeting is absolute truth. Since this is absolute truth, the little single-celled God in the womb of a virgin grew to be the God-man in order to make us people of God. And for his sake, the Lord is with you. Thanks be to Jesus. So we see how this text is so important for us. We like to read this text and only think, this is only applies to Mary. No, it applies to each and every one of you here at the font and here at the altar. God is always coming and overshadowing you. He is always filling you, always announcing to you that your sins are forgiven, that you are his dear child. Don't walk away from that, because he will not walk away from you. Continue to hold on to him, and to follow him, and to believe him, and to trust in him. And he will keep his promise. He will come for you, and to take you to where he is. Thanks be to Jesus. Therefore, my dear brother and sister, let's close in an unusual way. I invite you to open your hymnals now to our closing hymn, hymn 95. I'll give you a couple of seconds to do it. It shouldn't be too hard. 95. Hymn 95. And as you open to this hymn, take a close look at it. This is the most beautiful hymn ever written that clearly and poetically describes the Annunciation, the conception, and the birth of our Lord Jesus. Therefore, please rise, and let's close by praying a portion of this hymn. And what we're going to do is we're going to pray together stanzas 1, stanza 2, and stanza 7. Let us pray. Savior of the nations, come. Virgin Son, make here thy home. Marvel now, O heaven and earth, that the Lord chose such a birth. Not by human flesh and blood, by the Spirit of our God, was the Word of God made flesh, woman's offspring pure and fresh. Praise to God the Father sing, praise to God the Son our King, praise to God the Spirit be, ever and eternally. And in his name, the peace that surpasses all understanding, guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus, now and forever. Amen.